passionate about the issues that I'm running for mayor on that I tend to go over the time limit, and then when he says time's up, I go, oh no, it can't be up already. As most of you know, I'm a born and raised San Franciscan. I've been three generations. My grandmother was born in North Beach in late 1800s, and my father was born in North Beach. So I'm three generations San Franciscan, and I was, of course, born here. I have four children and five grandchildren. I have, for the last 18 years, I'm a civil rights trial lawyer, which means that I have defended in the courtrooms of America people who have been discriminated based on their religion, their disability, their race, national origin, age, sexual orientation, gender. I have represented many, many vets in my life as a trial lawyer, but as a supervisor and as president of the Board of Supervisors, I was the legislator for the vets during the, 1989 to 1997. It's always been a great honor to me to represent the vets. And of course, during that time, we had the situation of the vets coming home from Iraq in 1991, going to Iraq, coming home from Iraq in 1991, and the situation of just having the new homeless population increase so rapidly, and so much of it had to do with the vets and how we took care of post-traumatic stress, how we took care of mental illness. So I was the chair of the health committee for 8 years. Even when I was president of the Board of Supervisors, I was the chair of the mental health committee. I created the Mental Health Advisory Board. You know, I tell my juries all the time when I'm in closing argument that there's a very, very fine line between good mental health and bad mental health. And you have to be there for the person to help them to make sure that fine line doesn't get crossed. And we in public life have a great opportunity to help people when it comes to mental illness. We have never funded mental illness properly, never. In the 2000s, I did the 10-year plan to end chronic homelessness. I met with the Veterans Affairs Secretary of at the time was a principe, I say that in Italian way. I'm sure you all say, how do you all say it?
Principe.
Principe means prince. And so I used to meet with him all the time in Washington, D.C. And for the 8 years from 2004 to 2012, we received more federal funding from Veterans Affairs, from the Health Department, for mental health, Veterans Affairs. We even received homeless funding from the post office. The interagency that deals with homelessness has over 62 federal agencies. So in other words, homelessness isn't just about health. Homelessness isn't just about veterans and just about mental health and just about the things that we believe that it's just specifically about. It's about the post office, it's about transportation, it's about just about every different agency. So the interdepartmental agency that we worked with from 2004 to 2012 funded San Francisco more than in any time in the history of our city. So let me tell you a little bit about that plan, because I'm very proud of that plan. That plan worked. The 10-year plan to end chronic homelessness was a stellar, stellar success. And it ended in 2012. It ended when Gavin Newsom went to be lieutenant governor, and the new administration started, and then tech started coming to town in order to fill up the positions and the employment. So that's when it ended. But let me tell you, from 2004 to 2012, we housed 4,632 chronically homeless. That means people on the street from 4 to 6 years. Ladies and gentlemen, do you know how hard it is to house someone who lives on the street that long? They are embedded on the street. That is their way of life. It is very hard to convince them to come in off out of the street. And at the time, a whopping 38% of the 4,600 chronically homeless were our vets. I gave speech after speech when I was president of the Board of Supervisors and during the years 2000 to 2012 of the shame that we don't take care of our vets, especially those that are homeless in the streets, don't even know what benefits they could receive. I've worked with literally hundreds of vets to get their proper benefits so that they know what they can receive. So let me go back to the chronic homeless for a second. So out of 6,400 people, I'll get that one to me, the lack of recidivism, 94% of those people are still in the unit that we put them in. That is an amazing success story. So what happened was we had all of these buildings in the pipeline. We used 8 or 9 of them. Some of them had 300 units, some had 400 units. Really wonderful programs, master leases, and we moved the chronically homeless in. Or we moved them, if they couldn't get on their feet, then we would have triage and have to go the mental illness hospitalization, and then into some kind of temporary permit that led to permanent supportive housing. The key to a successful homeless plan, the key are the three words, permanent supportive housing. You can't put someone in a program for 6 months, have them get better, have them feel better about themselves, have them want to work, have them have some dignity, have them feel good about their time, whether it's in Iraq or Vietnam, have them feel like they're accomplished. You can't do that for 6 months and then put them back in the situation they came from. And that's what we were doing year after year after year. Permanent supportive housing, the chronic plan, would not do that. It put people right into units with a minute clinic on the bottom floor, which means there would be doctors downstairs. The perfect example of this is the YMCA on Golden Gate. The whole first floor had pro bono doctors from UCSF. And I see there are a couple of you here in the audience that helped us with this program. So I'm sure you remember how fantastic it was for someone who finally got into a unit to have medical care. So I could go on about this, and I don't have a lot of time, so I'm going to talk for a second about dirty streets and mental illness and substance abuse. But please look at the 10-year plan to end chronic homelessness. My goal today is to take people off the street within 72 hours, get them into some kind of, whether it's rehabilitation or whether it's a mental health issue, or whether indeed they can go right into housing. And that does exist. If you can get those that have been on the street not very long off, the sooner the better, you have much more of a probability of them staying off the streets. Right now, the largest group of homeless people, the new largest group of homeless people in the last year or two, are unaccompanied women. A large degree of them have been sexually violated at some point in their life, so they're hiding. And you can tell a mile away what their issues are and how to help them. So of course, the first thing to do would be to help them get off the streets as soon as possible. And that is my goal. Ladies and gentlemen, I am in this race because of the homeless situation. I'm in this race because of people living in tents, in disgrace, in a billion-dollar city, in an iconic city. I'm in this race to stop the horror of living on the streets, the horror of sitting down at the BART station and shooting up and slumping over while people who are going to their jobs just walk by. I'm stunned by this. And let me just mention a segue to this. Now, this is going to be a controversial topic, and I have never said this at a debate or an endorsement. The amount of unconscionable money spent in this mayor's race, $4.8 million, could have housed so many vets that tonight will be sleeping on our streets. This system is very messed up, very messed up. It's unconscionable to me that kind of money can be spent in a mayor's race with, you know, 10, 15, 20 flyers that cost $100,000 each while people are starving on our streets, while they're shooting up and basically killing themselves on our streets. So as mayor of San Francisco, my first job will be the chronically homeless. And obviously, an offshoot of that will be the newly homeless, to help them get off the streets, and of course help with the vet programs. I love the program that's in the Presidio. I love the program that's out at Treasure Island. Michael, I love that. I think those programs need to multiply. They work. Swords to Plowshare is perfect. It works. Why aren't we funding it? Why aren't we giving to the things we know? Oh my gosh, time's up. I knew it. The things we know work. So, you know, when I see people like Michael, or I see people like Ken, that are doing programs that are so wonderful, the program over near Lucas Films and the Presidio, it works. Let's fund that instead of wasting money. I could go on about mental health and other things, but I'll take the questions and try to
answer. Here's question number one. Over 40% of the post 9/11 veterans, the younger veterans in our community, and 20% of the pre 9/11 veterans, those mostly from the Vietnam era, have reported being homeless in their last year. On one hand, the San Francisco Department of Homelessness and Supportive Housing has reported significant difficulties in getting landlords to take the HUD batch vouchers. Mm-hmm. They're kind of like the Section 8 vouchers. On the other hand, many veterans have unstable living arrangements do not meet the Department of Housing and Urban Development definition of homelessness. And single-room occupancy, SRO housing, is not appropriate for older veterans who really need wraparound services. Right. So as mayor, what do you intend to do to make sure all veterans are appropriately housed in San Francisco?
You know, ladies and gentlemen, if I had to stop and pay attention to all the rules and regulations that HUD put on qualifying people to give them housing, we would not have housed the people that we housed. What we did was we went out and we got the buildings. At the time, we had 18 buildings in the pipeline. We took master leases on them, and we put people literally from the street into rehab or from the street into mental health services with wraparound care, and then into the unit that would have, as I said, the Minute Clinic in the area. The frustration of picking someone up who has served so many years of their life for us in a war where they put their life on the line, and then we go try to get them the HUD services, and one of the restrictions is something to do with where they were born, or some of the restrictions of HUD were just impossible for us to deal with. So what we really did was get as much state and, we also got as much federal help as we could, but we went to the Veterans Affairs Secretary. We got to know him. In other words, it's a one-on-one relationship. It's pick the phone up and say, "Hi, Secretary Principe, it's Angela in San Francisco. This is what is happening with this particular requirement. How do we overcome this requirement so that we can put Harry into the unit we have for him?" And I'm telling you, even on an individual basis, when you have a personal relationship with the people in Washington and the people in Sacramento, it changes everything. It changes everything. For the last 15 years of my life, when I see a homeless person on the street, I pick the phone up and I call Gavin. I say, "Gavin, this person is on Geary and Steiner. Please come pick them up." And then I wait until they're picked up and I follow their progress. Dealing with homelessness and dealing with HUD regulations and dealing with state regulations is hard work. My goal is to put Harry into an apartment or to put Harry into mental health services. That's my goal. And if I have obstacles in the way, it sounds like, you know, this is easy to do. It isn't easy, but I do it anyway, and we did it, and we were highly, highly successful. So unfortunately, we also have a lot of local rules that are more onerous than the HUD rules. And that is something we can stop right away with the Board of Supervisors or a powerful mayor that cares.
Thank you. We should do this a little differently. Since we have 10 minutes for four questions, maybe we'll do a count up, and so you can hold it for 2 minutes when she goes to 2 minutes, or 3 minutes when she goes to 3 minutes. Can we do that? Okay, so that way you know what your case is. All right, so question number two, mental health. One-third of veterans have considered suicide or have made plans to end their life by suicide. 53% of post-9/11 veterans screened positive for PTSD. 64% screened positive for depression. Pre-9/11 veterans, PTSD at 41%, depression, and 35% post-9/11 veterans are twice as likely. I'm sorry, I screwed this up. Pre-9/11 veterans, PTSD 41%, depression. Post-9/11 veterans are twice as likely as pre-9/11 veterans to engage in high-risk taking behaviors like driving after drinking alcohol, carrying a weapon, or looking to start a fight. Nearly 60% of post-9/11 veterans have a probable alcohol drinking problem. 50% of veterans have reported a significant physical or mental health issue for which they are not receiving care. These numbers tell me that we are facing an unprecedented crisis of mental health issues and a wave of second-tier effects affecting the families, co-workers, and friends of veterans in our community. As mayor, what will you do to improve mental health services in San Francisco?
The idea of a mayor going out of her way to make it clear to the city's budget, to the city's departments, as I said before, they're all interdepartmental that deal with the mental illness of a vet. Okay, there's several departments. The idea of an active advocating mayor would change that entire scenario, in my opinion. But let me just say one more time. This is a tough, tough issue. When I created the Mental Health Advisory Board in 1995, I was called crazy time and time again. People don't want to hear about mental illness, and they want to say to you, oh, tell them to get over it. I heard tell them to get over it so many times. But when you meet people on the streets that are homeless vets, that are clearly disabled because of the mental illness, they're the people you could help the easiest. Now let me just mention Project Homeless Connect. Is he timing me?
Yes.
Am I up already with that 2 minutes?
No.
Okay, I just don't want to go over the 2 minutes. I just want to say, Project Homeless Connect, ladies and gentlemen, was a fantastic program. In other words, we've done things that work. Again, like swords to plowshare. We know what works. Let's multiply it. Let's multiply it. Let's. We don't have to recreate the wheel when we have something that works as wonderful as swords to plowshare, Project Homeless Connect, the 10-year plan to end chronic homelessness. All of these things address mental illness. The 10-year plan not only addressed mental illness, but I actually had psychiatrists come in from all over the nation to tell us what kind of vitamins we should be giving to those who are mentally ill on the street to try to help their brain repair while we were getting the housing, the permanent supportive housing. So you all should go to the city website and just put in chronic plan, and you'll see how extensive the parts on our veterans are, because veterans are a large, large percentage of it. An advocating loudmouth like me, I'm a loudmouth Sicilian, loudmouth person who understands mental health the way I have worked on it for the last 25, 30 years, is somebody in the mayor's office that would make a huge difference to those staggering statistics. And so hopefully you all vote for me number one, because this is one area I really know what I'm talking about.
Thank you. The third question is employment, is this working? And I'll just speak up. Veterans face a disproportionately high rate of unemployment and underemployment in San Francisco. 80% of service members leave the military without a job. And almost 60% of post-9/11 veterans in San Francisco reported that their military skills and experiences are dismissed by employers. As a result, 83% of post-9/11 veterans who work full-time have an annual salary that is below $60,000 a year, and 40% with jobs reporting earning below $36,000 a year. That is simply not enough to survive, much less live a dignified life in this bourgeois town.
Right.
As mayor, what will you do to make sure veterans find appropriate employment in San Francisco?
You know, let me tell you a little bit about, I'm a civil rights lawyer, okay? I have represented many vets, and the discrimination against vets is stunning. When you add to the discrimination of someone who has gone to war for us to protect us, when you add an age issue or a disability issue to it, it's almost impossible to find a job. So I have created something called a legacy tenant, and that is someone that has lived in their apartment now I'm talking about evictions, because evictions is a big problem for our vets. A legacy tenant is someone who's lived in their apartment, who's no fault, who has paid their rent, cannot be moved from their apartment by any LS Act or any other act, cannot be evicted from their apartment if they have been there 10 years or more and they are a vet. So it's a dedicated type of housing for vets, teachers, nurses, and emergency services. Now, San Francisco's major affordable housing issue, you know what they're calling affordable housing? When I first started this race, I thought affordable housing was going to be $40,000. I mean, my clients, you know, make $25,000, $30,000, $50,000, $60,000. Affordable housing, as defined by San Francisco's percentage in putting it into a developer's new project, is $130,000. So where are the people making $50,000, $60,000, $70,000, $80,000? Where do they live? Where do they live? So all throughout this mayor's race, we have developed on my campaign, we have developed dedicated housing for people making anywhere from $40,000, $50,000, $60,000. Let me just give you an example that could be applicable to veterans, absolutely. And that is a 350-unit building for nurses only. No matter what their pay is, the rent is only a percentage of that pay. So if the nurse is making $50,000 or $40,000 and another one is making $130,000, their rent is dependent upon their amount of salary. And they're within distance of the hospital. So that kind of dedicated housing has to be done for people that make under $130,000. And that is something that, can you just imagine how wonderful it would be to actually give people really nice, decent housing? And something they can afford that's dedicated for especially who they are, like a vet, like a nurse, like a teacher. So that housing issue is a huge issue, and discrimination of vets. I have won many trials for vets, but it's generally vets with disabilities or vets over 40 years old. The discrimination is terrible because they can hire people that are 22 years old that have all these new skills. So that is something I would fight vigorously. Especially for city jobs. Our vets should have our city jobs.
Yeah, great. Thank you.
Yes.
Okay, question number four. We're past our 10 minutes, so we have, we have to rush through this. That's okay. Community. Nearly 75% of all veterans in San Francisco have reported difficulties adjusting to civilian life, and 33% reported that they do not know where to go or who to contact to get help. Nearly two-thirds of post-9/11 veterans indicate that civilians do not appreciate the sacrifices they've made, with more than 80% indicating that civilians don't understand their problems. As mayor, what will you do to help reintegrate veterans into our community?
All I can think of is, what comes to mind immediately with this question is Project Homeless Connect. When people came into Project Homeless Connect, we connected them with every possible funding source. We connected them with every possible, we would repair wheelchairs, every possible dentist appointment, every possible. It was a program that was so wonderful, and especially for vets, because we would connect them with all of the benefits. There's so many vets out there on the street that have no idea what they could possibly get from the government, whether it's the federal, state, or local government. And one other thing I just absolutely need to say here is we cannot let the federal government off the hook when it comes to our vets. They have got to pay attention and pay what the pay their dues to our vets instead of ignoring them. And that is so obvious in the homeless situation. So when it comes to services and things, dedicated services for vets is something that would make world of difference for so many of the vets. Even those that have jobs don't really understand all the services they could get. And then when they get terminated, there need to be specific sanctions for terminating someone because they're a vet or of a certain age. And again, as a civil rights trial lawyer, I've been very, very successful at that, so I spotted a mile away.
Thank you. Liz, let's have a round of applause for you.
Dedication and service to our great country. Thank you from the bottom of my heart.
Wait a minute.
We have structured questions.
I know you gave all the questions out. What about us in the audience? Well, I'm a veteran at Fort Miley. I'm representing the opioid replacement program of fellow veterans who have problems get to the VA for their dosage or for their mental health assistance. They commute bus, they end up with a fine because they don't have the money to travel. So what about the community provide free transportation services for all veterans?
That's absolutely something I would look at. Absolutely, I think that's a great idea. I think that's a great idea. And it wouldn't cost us anything the way we're spending it. I think that's a great idea. I'm going to adopt that in my campaign. I would really like that. Thank you.
Totally.